I think you should have in front of you what I'm going to say today. And I, and as you've heard from Amy, this work is really important. And I'll talk a little bit further about that, and then my colleague, my good colleague and friend, Mary Starrett, will follow me and talk a little bit about the work, advise the task force a little bit more on what we've been doing in Colorado with the Colorado Daylight Partnership. I am thankful to Governor Polis, you as the Behavioral Health Task Force members, and the Behavioral Health Task Force staff for this opportunity for me and other Coloradans to share our insights on how we can work together to ensure that every Coloradan experiencing behavioral health needs receives timely, high-quality services in their community. I was so excited that that was the mission of this task force. My name is Ric Durity, and I'm the Vice President for Development at the Mental Health Center of Denver. I first came to work in Colorado's public mental health system more than 30 years ago. I know, I was young. To implement outpatient clinical services and programs for deaf and hard of hearing persons in Metro Denver. In my current role, I have the privilege to lead our organization's efforts to secure philanthropic and grant funding for a portfolio of innovative programs and services designed to enhance access to care for people of all ages and in all communities throughout Denver. With my colleague Mary Starrett, who'll be speaking in a few minutes, I also co-direct the Colorado Daylight Partnership. You'll find detailed information about the Colorado Daylight Partnership in a handout that we've prepared for you. And the vision of the Colorado Daylight Partnership is to create equitable and sustainable access to behavioral health care for deaf, hard of hearing, and deaf-blind individual Coloradans throughout our statewide system of care. I'm hard of hearing. And just as you've heard from my colleague and friend Amy about the challenges she and her family have faced in accessing quality behavioral health services, I too have experienced barriers in accessing healthcare. I'm here today to say that creating equitable access to care for deaf and hard of hearing Coloradans is within reach. In conjunction with the work of the Behavioral Health Task Force in early December, deaf and hard of hearing Coloradans shared their input in a town hall hosted by the Colorado Commission for the Deaf, Hard of Hearing, and Deaf Blind, and Lieutenant Governor Primavera. Thanks to Cliff Morris, who's here with us today at the Commission, Lieutenant Governor Primavera, and Summer Gathercole for creating that event. At the town hall, we heard that while some deaf and hard of hearing Coloradans are able to receive life-sustaining and important behavioral health services, others struggle to find accessible services. Inequitable access to publicly funded behavioral health services for deaf and hard of hearing Coloradans has been documented. A 2015 data analysis funded by the Colorado Office of Behavioral Health, using available prevalence data from the Colorado Population and Needs Study, showed that while 28% of the general population of Coloradans in greatest need of receiving behavioral health services receive services in one of Colorado's community mental health clinics, in stark contrast, only 3% of Colorado's deaf and hard of hearing citizens in need of services receive them. The state of Colorado is recognized nationally for the work the state has funded in developing standards of care for publicly funded providers to provide access to high quality services for this population. The Colorado Standards of Care for Behavioral Health Services for Deaf and Hard of Hearing were designed as a resource to support the efforts of all publicly funded behavioral health providers in the state to provide equitable access. The standards of care were developed through a community-informed process, bringing together consumers of behavioral health services who were deaf and hard of hearing. We know the standards of care are readily adopted when technical assistance is available to provider organizations interested in implementing them. Provider organizations are incentivized to implement them, and there's oversight to ensure that organizations are in compliance with federal and state regulations as they relate to the Americans with Disabilities Act and the Affordable Care Act. when Dedicaid funding has been available from the state to support equitable access. Coloradans who are deaf, hard of hearing, or deafblind report less discrimination and higher levels of satisfaction in receiving behavioral health services. Funding to support statewide technical assistance has been cyclic. And from my perspective, my 30-year perspective on this, it sometimes seems tied to the threat of legal action against the state by the deaf and hard of hearing community. When access to services is dependent on inconsistent funding, organizations are less likely to initiate community outreach and engagement efforts with Coloradans who are deaf, hard of hearing, or deafblind. So it becomes a sort of double conundrum. The task force has already heard testimony about the workforce challenges facing us in the behavioral health industry. Nationally, the behavioral health workforce has decreased by 14% since 2008. The impact has been even more adverse for specialized staff needed for to serve this population. Staff with specialized expertise who are culturally and linguistically relevant for this population often are trained in other states. We will continue to experience a crisis in recruiting and retaining qualified staff unless we can pay better. And since positions and salaries are tied to available funding, inconsistent funding to serve this population means qualified professionals are less likely to relocate to Colorado and thus go to other states where there's more consistent funding. Dedicated and sustainable funding to serve populations like this one, there needs to be dedicated funding. Even well-intended provider organizations cannot dedicate the necessary funds to create access for this population. Previously, Colorado had a financing model to advance access for Coloradans who are deaf, hard of hearing, or deafblind. That funding model needs to be revisited. Thank you.
Thank you.
And we're probably a little over time, I see, so.
That's okay. I have a quick question for you. Sure.
Sure.
Outside of additional funding and increasing salaries, are there other recommendations you would have about recruiting workforce, especially in specialty areas?
So what I appreciate about that question too is that it applies to other specialty areas that we see. So part of that is I think having capacity to develop some of that workforce in state, and then to also be able to create internship opportunities for those with institutions that train this specialty providers that are sign fluent, ASL sign fluent. And so we have had those relationships with some of those institutions in the past, but Colorado is sort of a less desirable place for interns to come because they're looking for that continuity in being able to seek employment here after their internship. So we've been less able to recruit because of that conundrum. We have two positions open for clinical positions at the Mental Health Center of Denver right now that have been, one of which has been open for almost 6 months, and another one's been open for 3 months.
Mm-hmm.